So the next one,
Coelenterata.
so this is the second phylum in the animal kingdom, Coelenterata. Here the examples are Hydra, corals, and we have what else we have in Coelenterata? Hydra, we have corals, we have a jellyfish. So these are the different examples of Coelenterata. So in this Coelenterata, they have a body cavity, and their bodies are made up of some cylinder-like bodies. They have some cylinder-like bodies, and in these bodies they have two layers of cells. Their body is having a two layer of cells, and there is a cavity inside the body. So we find some cavity, some space inside the body, two layers of cells, outer layer and forming inner layer. So in the Coelenterata, animals like Hydra, they have arms or tentacles. So tentacles. So with the tentacles, the Hydra, it moves by different modes of movement. It has locomotion, not like porifera. So in the first case, we have seen the poriferans, they are the sponges which have a hard surface and which are fixed to the solid surface or ground. So these are the different ones. Coelenterata, they move, even the jellyfish moves. And corals are fixed. Corals, even though they are very tiny in size, the corals, they join to one another. That is, they live in a colony of corals. Even though they are very small, they can form very big colony, a colony of some 1800 square kilometers. 1800 square kilometers. So sea anemone, jellyfish, coral and hydra are the examples of the Coelenterata. So what are the features here? They have a cavity. So that is why coelom, they have cavity, body cavity, that is coelom. That is why they're called a Coelenterata. They have the tentacles, and their body is having two layers of cells. The covering of the body is having two layers of cells. So outer covering, outer lining, inner lining, there is a cavity. So these organisms, they feed on other organisms, they capture the other organisms and take them as a food. So the next phylum in this animal kingdom, it is Platyhelminthes. So in this Platyhelminthes, mainly we see parasitic worms. Parasitic worms, which are mostly flat shaped. So their bodies are flat. They are dorso-ventrally compressed. So both side, on the front side, stomach side, and on the back side also compressed flat. So in this Platyhelminthes, we see tapeworm. The tapeworm is just like a measuring tape. So it is a very lengthy parasite. It may grow up to certain meters also. So these tapeworms are generally seen in buffalo stomachs, in the buffalo's intestines. So these are, they live as a parasite inside the body of an organism, or they can live independently also. They can lead an independent life. Mostly they are seen as a parasite inside the bodies of organisms. That is, in the intestines, they grow up to meters of length. They feed on the food that is eaten by the animal. So the food which is eaten and digested by the animal, that food will be used by these animals like tapeworms. So now let us see their characteristics. So they have a three layers of cells. So they are called as triploblastic. In the previous case, we have seen the Hydra, it is having two layers of cells called as a diploblastic. This is three layered triploblastic. So these, each layer of cell can differentiate into different tissues. That means it can form different organs. So can be differentiated into tissues, triploblastic, three layers. And the another important feature, triploblastic is one important feature of this Platyhelminthes. The next one is bilateral symmetry. bilateral symmetry. What is bilateral symmetry? Bilateral symmetry, in maths you are learning symmetry. What is symmetry? If there is an animal like this, so now I have drawn two figures of two animals. So if I cut this animal into two, and even if I cut this animal into two, I say this is A, this is B. So which animal is cut into two equal halves, identical halves? These two are identical halves. So an organism, if it is having identical halves on both sides, it is called as bilateral symmetry. So these flatworms, they have bilateral symmetry. So if you cut the flatform equally, if you cut the flatform to center, you will get two equal halves, two similar halves. What I mean to say is two similar halves, in this case dissimilar. This shape is different, this shape is different. So that bilateral symmetry is observed in case of this Platyhelminthes. So Platyhelminthes, examples are parasitic worms like a tapeworm and liver fluke and planarians. These are the examples of the Platyhelminthes. So the next phylum, Nematoda. So in Nematoda also we find parasitic worms. Parasitic worms, just like the before phylum, Platyhelminthes. In Platyhelminthes, the parasitic worms are flat. Here these nematode worms are also diploblastic. That means having three layers of cells which can be differentiated into tissues. So which can form organs, but there are no true organ system inside. But they have tissues which can form. They have layers of cells which can form different tissues and organs. So diploblastic in nature, and these are not flat as like Platyhelminthes. These nematodes are cylindrical, like cylinders, round. So that is the reason why they are called as round worms. So they have some cavity inside, coelomic cavity, pseudocoelom. They have cylindrical round bodies. They have some special structures like pin at the end of their bodies. They have hook like structures and they have sucker like structures. Even Platyhelminthes tapeworm is also having a sucker like special structure. So here these are also having pin or hook like structures. So these are mostly parasitic worms which cause so many diseases in human beings. In human beings they cause AP&TS. AP&TS means, in case the normal leg of a person, so this is the leg of a person, if it is infected with AP&TS, the leg of the person becomes like this. So the AP&TS is caused by one kind of this nematode parasite. So in the same way, AP&TS is caused, and the roundworm infection or the hookworm infection, so these are all caused by this nematode worms. So roundworm infection, that is in the stomach, and hookworms or pinworms that cause itching in the near the anus. So these are also intestinal worms. These are all intestinal worms. So this is the Nematoda. So let us see the next phylum, Annelida. So in case of the Annelida, we find the animals like earthworms. So under this Annelida, earthworms, leeches, such animals, they come. So these annelidans, they are triploblastic, that means they have three layers of cells. They have a true coelom, body cavity. Coelom means body cavity. They have a true body cavity. Body cavity means, if this is the body wall, if this is the animal, so inside there is some space and which true organs can be formed and the organs can be protected. So the body cavity is there, in that the coelom is there and true organs are there, the true organs are founded. The true organs are found in these annelida and their body is having segmentation. So if this is the earthworm, if you see the earthworm, on the body of the earthworm you can find some ring like markings. So you will find that there the earthworm body is having so many segments, and here and there some special segments. So the body is segmented, the body is cylindrical. Inside the body there is a cavity, true coelom, and they are triploblastic in nature and they have a differentiation, organ differentiation. So they have segments and they have organs. For example, their reproductive organs are located in particular segment. So if you look at the particular segment, if you count the number of segment on the particular segment, you can find their reproductive organs or excretory organs. So in this way, the differentiation is there in case of annelida. So in annelida, the examples, earthworms and leeches. So both of them will be having segmented body. On their body, you can find so many segments like this. The next phylum, arthropoda. Arthropoda. So the meaning of arthropoda means jointed legs. Poda means legs. Arthro means jointed. So the animals in this class, in this phylum, they have jointed legs. So what are the examples? Prawns and insects, almost all the insects, prawns and scorpions. Okay, so cockroaches, house flies, butterflies, all these come into this arthropoda. They have jointed legs and they have bilateral symmetry. See, if you observe a cockroach, so it will be having a bilateral symmetry and it will be having a jointed legs. It will have jointed legs. If you see a scorpion also, you can find the body is segmented. The body is segmented and moreover it has got a jointed legs, and they have an exoskeleton. One more feature is that exoskeleton. That means skeleton outside their body. Whereas if you see higher animals like humans and all, we have a skeleton inside the body. The skeleton is covered by muscles and skin. But in these cases, they have an outer skeleton. That is called as exoskeleton. And they have a true body cavity. They have different organs. But their body cavity, their coelomic cavity is filled with white color blood. So they have white blood. They have open circulatory system. Ours is closed circulatory system. The blood, it flows in closed blood vessels and in heart. But in their body, the blood directly flows into the body cavity. So it is not very quickly pumped, just it is an open circulatory system. So the coelomic cavity is filled with white color blood, in this case of this arthropoda. So the next, mollusca. Mollusca are the soft bodied organisms. Their bodies are very soft. Very soft. Example, we can see that snail, oyster. If you see this snail and oyster, they're very soft and smooth organisms, smooth animals. If you see the snail, so here we can find the bilateral symmetry. I told you that what is bilateral symmetry? That is, the animal is having two identical halves. That is, bilateral symmetry is seen, and they have a coelomic cavity, they have open blood circulatory system, open circulatory system. Their blood is not white, of course, but sometimes the snail blood is blue in color because of some pigment. Open circulatory system they have, And they have a foot-like organ, foot. The snails, they have a foot-like organ by using which they move very slowly. And their bodies are covered by hard shell. The snail is protected in a shell. Snail is protected by a So this way it will be having a shell in which it is covered. So these are the characteristic features of the mollusca. So the next phylum, Echinodermata. So the animals in this Echinodermata, they have a spiny skin. See, Echino means hedgehog. Dermata means skin. Means that they have a skin like a hedgehog. So they have a spiny skin. Example, starfish, sea urchin, these are the examples. If you see a starfish, how is the starfish? The starfish is having five arms. So they have a calcium exoskeleton, so which is made up of calcium. So they have a calcareous exoskeleton. They are triploblastic. They have a body cavity. They are triploblastic, three layers of cells, and they have a body cavity. So they have some kind of canal system, some radial canal system through which the water passes, because these organisms are marine. They live in salt water, so they are marine. They have a special canal system through which the water passes out. So they have a hard calcium made shell outside their body. Examples are sea urchins and starfishes. Protochordata. So these animals are also triploblastic, as like the previous phylums, Coelenterata or Echinodermata. So these are also triploblastic in nature, just like the Echinodermata, and we have seen that Annelida, Arthropoda. So those phylums, they have a triploblastic three layer of cells. In the same way, they have a body cavity also. These protochordates, they have a body cavity, coelom. Body cavity, they have organ differentiation, and moreover, more than that, the previous phylums, this phylum has got an additional feature, that is the presence of notochord. So what is this notochord? Notochord is a string-like structure. A chord means a string-like structure that separates. What it separates? It separates the gut and nerve tissue. So nerve tissue and gut, both are separated by the notochord. If this is the body of the organism, here is the elementary canal, digestive system. This is the digestion part. And here, actually, the digestion part is connected with the nervous tissue in these lower forms. But in this protochordata phylum, so in the previous forms, there is no distinction between nervous tissue and the elementary canal, the digestive part. So this gut, the digestive part, and nervous tissue are separated by notochord. Of course, this notochord is not found in all stages of its life. At certain stages of its life, the notochord is present in this protochordata. So this notochord, see, this is the gut, this is the nervous tissue. In between the nerve tissue and gut, there is a cord called notochord. So this notochord not only separates the nervous tissue and the gut, so it will give some support to the muscles and other body parts can be connected to the notochord. It provides some support which helps in the movement of the organism. So that is the improvement we see in this phylum when compared to the previous phylums. So here the examples are balanoglasses, and Hadmania, So these are the examples of protocoordinator. Okay, so we are going to talk about the last phylum of this animal kingdom, vertebrata. So vertebrates are the well-developed animals. So they have got triploblastic, so they have got different features. Triploblastic in nature. They have got a true vertebral column. And they have got an internal skeleton. They got a true vertebral column. They are triploblastic. There is a lot of organ differentiation. There are different organs and there are different systems. The ciliated cavity is filled with organs and the differentiation of tissues is extensive. So many variations of tissues, different kinds of tissues are organized, and the muscles are connected to the skeleton at different points. Muscle connection points are there, so very good locomotion. Bodies are segmented, so jointed joints are found, bodies are segmented. So we see all the development when compared to all the other phylums in this animal kingdom. So here the vertebrates are of the higher class, which have development in all the different body parts and in their differentiation and in their body complexity. If you look at the classification of these vertebrata, it is divided into five major groups. We see the first one Pisces, second one amphibians, and the third one is reptiles, and the fourth one aves or birds, and fifth one mammals. So these are the classes. So Pisces, all the fishes come under the Pisces. Fishes, they have gills and they have a two-chambered heart. Fishes are cold-blooded animals. That means they can change the temperature of their blood according to the environment. That is the cold-blooded nature. So that is found, and they have gills to breathe. So they have different organ systems, like they have digestive system, they have excretory system and reproductive. Differentiated systems are found in their blood, and the fishes, they have the bony skeleton inside the body. Endoskeleton is seen, which is made up of bone, except some shark and other fishes. Most of the fishes have these features. And if we look at that, the next one, amphibians are able to live in water and on land, and they have a special features, like breathing through their moist skin. So examples are the frogs and salamanders. They come under amphibians, which have a moist skin, is the special and particular feature of their group. So they breathe through their skin. Even they have lungs to breathe, they breathe through their gills when they are in the form of a larva. So if we look at the reptiles, they have special features like scales on their skins. They crawl on the surfaces, reptiles, and they lay eggs. They are oviparous. They lay eggs to give birth. They do not give birth to the young ones. So what comes under reptiles are the snakes and lizards. They come under the reptiles. And if we move to the aves are the birds. They are the warm-blooded animals. They have feathers on their bodies, and birds have got hollow bones, the bony structure. They have internal skeleton, so they have a differentiation of the muscles. All the systems are well developed compared to the previous. So the mammals are the vertebrates that give birth to the young ones, that feed the young ones with their milk. And examples are the human beings: cows, buffaloes, goat, dog, sheep, cat. So all these come under mammals. Mammals are warm-blooded. So that means they have constant body temperature. So their body temperature is fixed. So these are the features of the mammals. So if we observe the different systems, like circulatory system in these different groups of these vertebrate, you can see that amphibians and pisces, they have two chambered heart, and amphibians have partly three chambered heart, even reptiles have three chambered, partly four chambered, and aves, they have four chambered, and mammals have four chambered heart. So in case of mammals, they have a four chambered complete heart and a closed circulatory system. Even the aves also have a closed circulatory system. The blood flows in a closed blood vessel, and there is a heart to pump the blood. In case of reptiles, we find, and in case of amphibians also we find, in case of pisces also we find, but the number of chambers in the heart are different. When it is the case of mammals, we find a completely developed four chambered heart to pump the blood throughout the body. So now we are going to discuss about nomenclature. What is nomenclature? So nomenclature is naming the organisms, either plants or animals. So why should we give a specific or special name to a plant or animal? Because people around the world, they use different languages. So they call the names of plants or animals in their local languages. So if the local languages, the local names are assigned to plant or animal, it will be very difficult to study. So it leads to confusion. Say, for example, potato is called as a potato in English. It is the English name of potato. It changes in Hindi, aloo. In Telugu, it changes to Bangala Dumpa. So see the variation. So here it is called as, in Hindi it is called as aloo, in English it is called as potato, in Telugu it is called as Bangala Dumpa. So the same plant but different names. So it leads to confusion. So it is not the correct way of naming plants and animals. So the plants and animals are named as given by Carl Linnaeus, which is having two parts in the name. One is the generic, the other one is the specific name. So the plants and animals are named according to this generic and specific. For example, Indian neem tree. So if you see the scientific name of this neem tree, Ajadi Recta Indica. So Ajadi Recta is the genus name, Indica is the species name. So here, when we are writing this name, there are some rules. Here I made a mistake. While writing a generic name, we can use the first letter capital, but in the species name, we should not use the capital, only small letter. So in the way, there are certain rules while writing the scientific name of an organism. Let us see. So we take another example, mango tree. So mango tree, if we are going to write the scientific name of mango tree, it is Mangifera Indica. So the scientific name, when we are writing the generic name or the genus name, the first letter can be the capital, whereas the species name, the first letter of the species name should not be a capital, it should be a small letter. And if the name of a plant or animal, the scientific name, if it is printed, they should be printed in italics. Italic in the sense, slanting letters. If you are writing a scientific name by hand, the two names are to be underlined separately like this. They should be underlined and separately. So capital letter for the generic name, small letter for the specific name. So these are the rules that are to be followed while writing the scientific name of a plant or an animal. So this gives the complete details. If you look at this Mangifera Indica, the Mangifera Indica talks about the genus of the plant, And indica talks about the species of the plant, which helps us to study easily without any confusion. So in this lesson, diversity in living organisms, we have studied about the diversity, how the classification has done. So we studied that this diverse world of living organisms can be grouped based upon the differences and similarities. So we have observed what characteristics we can take as a basic for the grouping or classification, and how the variations help in the classification grouping of organisms. And we have studied the relationship between the classification and evolution, and we studied about the different people who have given different classifications, like Carl Linnaeus, animal kingdom, plant kingdom, and Whittaker's five kingdom, like Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae, Animalia. So later we studied the different kingdoms and phylums and their characteristic features, and we have studied about the nomenclature also. So in this chapter, we understood the diversity in the living world and how the diversity is studied by the process of classification. So how can we study a particular organism, and how the classification helps to study the organism in a better way and in a easier way.